Sushruta for Neet is now available on the Google Play Store. Try it out for free.
Good morning, students. In our last class, if you remember, we started the factors influencing rate of reaction. Since we have studied about few of the factors, particularly concentration, we started in details. So what we know, these are four factors that mostly affect the rate of reaction. And the concentration, temperature, presence of catalyst, surface area of reactants, or even if there is a catalyst, if that matters, that also affect the rate of reaction. And usually, if the catalyst surface is saturated, then that surface may not be surface area of catalyst, may not affect the rate of reaction. But at low pressure, if the gaseous reactants are in the gaseous system, at low pressure, the surface area of reactants may also matter, or catalyst also may matter for the rate of reaction. So then we studied about the rate law or the rate equation or rate expressions, and this rate law, rate expression, or rate equation, all there. This is the same name for the different names for the same thing, and that is very important for us to remember. It's a very important concept in chemical kinetics. And as we know, for this example, we have seen if for a representative reaction, A moles of A reacts with B moles of B to give C moles of C and D moles of D, and we can write a rate expression or rate law for such reactions as rate is equal to K into A to the power X into B to the concentration of B to the power Y. Here X is the order of reaction with respect to A reactant A, and Y is the order of reaction with respect to reactant B. There we also studied, I have said that this X and Y may or may not be equal to A and B. Usually it is not equal to X. A and B for elementary reactions and for other reactions, but just for few complex reactions only, it becomes equal, and that becomes equal by chance. And so the rate, this, because this is the order of reaction, and we studied order of reaction, then overall order of a reaction will be equal to X plus Y. And the X, again I say, X is order of reaction with respect to reactant A, and Y is the order of reaction with respect to reactant B. In this rate expression or rate law, what we usually, this rate we write is the instantaneous rate of a reaction, and means at a particular instant, what is the concentration of A and concentration of B in this reaction, and that determines according to the order of the reaction, because order of reaction is raised to the power concentration, instantaneous concentration of A and instantaneous concentration of B. And this form of reaction, when we write, we call it a differential rate equation, because we are writing it in the form of differential. So dr by dt minus, we are writing because r is a reactant, and so this its concentration will decrease to make the entire thing positive. Minus sign is added before it, and this so this differential rate equation, now we know, we understand, and accordingly, as for the rate order of reaction and what is the order, I have explained earlier, today also I say. So something is in this differential rate equation or the rate equation, some power to the concentration is added, and these values are added based on the experimental observations or the experimental data. And whatever the values that we get to the concentration to the power, that we call as the order of the reaction. And then we show some examples, and later on we also looked about the molecular rate constant. And another point that I just want to tell you, this K is called the rate constant. This value, this K, which is a constant, because the rate is found to be proportional to concentration of A to the power X and concentration of B to the power Y. And to just remove this proportionality, we need to add certain constant, and that's why this constant is a proportionality constant. And in this context, this proportionality constant is called rate constant. And rate constant for different reactions may be different. Different reactions of the same order may also be different. Rate constant may also be different. And so some examples we have seen, and later on we have seen about the molecularity of the reaction. This is also a very important point, and molecularity is mostly defined for the elementary reactions. So what are the elementary and complex reactions that we have also seen? Elementary reaction happens in only one state, and complex reactions, the reactions, although it appears that so this reactant and this reactant react this many moles of this reactant react with this many moles of this particular reactant to form this many moles of compound, but what we see in this process of this chemical reactions, many reactions happens in different states, and those steps happens in the cascade, and those in steps what we see the formation of intermediates, and the intermediates now once it is formed and later on it is being consumed, and so once formed and later being consumed, so what we see overall it gets cancelled out, and so we don't see their representation in the overall chemical equation, and that is why they are actually the information about the intermediate in the overall of the net reaction, a chemical reaction for the complex type of reactions is lacks. But those reactions we need to understand are happening in the stepwise process, and there are many steps that are involved to happen this reaction, and such reactions are called complex reactions. So molecularity is defined only for the elementary reactions, and elementary reactions in the balanced elementary reactions, the stoichiometric coefficients of reactants will tell us about the molecularity. And based on that, we know the unimolecular, bimolecular, trimolecular, tetramolecular reactions, few things that we have studied, and you can just go and revise it. And some important points, I'll just from here, I'm going to start things afresh. And so this order of a reaction is a experimental quantity. This is what we have I have explained earlier. The order is always an experimental quantity. You cannot just look at the reaction and tell what is the order, what would be the order of reaction. One cannot predict order of a reaction. This is because to find out the information about the order of reaction, you have to first write the differential rate law, and differential rate law or rate law, the rate expression, and to write that rate expression, you have to have the information about how the rate of reaction changes if a particular reaction concentration of a particular reaction is changed. And so order of a reaction is experimental quantity. It can be zero or even a fraction or a negative value, but molecularity cannot be zero or a non-integer, because this is a balanced chemical reaction. We know that all the coefficients, the stoichiometric coefficients, are integer, and so even if you add them, the value you will get will be the integer only. So molecularity cannot be a zero or even the non-integer or even negative. Order is applicable to elementary as well as complex reactions, whereas molecularity is applicable only for elementary reactions. And for complex reactions, molecularity has no meaning, as I said earlier. So for complex reactions, order is given by slowest step, and molecularity of the slowest step is same as the order of the overall reaction. These are the information, just a summary of what few things, important things that we have studied last time. Let's see this couple of questions. So for a reaction, A plus B gives product. The rate law is given by R is equal to K, this is the rate constant, A to the power half, concentration of A to the power half into concentration of B to the power 2. We have to find out the order of the reaction. So in this rate law or the rate expression, what we see, K is the rate constant, A is concentration of reactant A, and is the power to the concentration of reactant A, but we see is half. So this half, 1 by 2, is order of reaction with respect to A. And what we see, the concentration of B to the raised to the power 2. And so 2 is the order of reaction with respect to reactant B. To get the overall order of the reaction, we need to add all the order of reactions with respect to all the reactants. So order of reaction with respect to all the reactants we have to add to get a sum. So half plus 2, in this case we get 2.5 as the overall order of reaction. This A plus B gives product. Now let's look at this question. The conversion of molecules X to Y follows second order kinetics. So there is only one reactant, so X, it gives Y as a product, and it follows second order kinetics. So for this reaction, we can write the expression as R is equal to K into concentration of x to the power 2. This is how we can write the rate expression if you know the order of the reaction, and also if you know the what are the reactants. So this reactant, there is only one type of reactant x, and the order of reaction is 2. So one can write that expression as R is equal to K into concentration of x to the power 2. Now if concentration of x is increased to 3 times, so what the next information is, the concentration of x is increased 3 times, how will it affect the rate of formation of y? So means rate of formation of y, if it is asking, it means it is asking about the rate of the reaction. And as we know, as I said, R is equal to K into concentration of x to the power 2. This is what we have seen. Now the concentration has become 3 into x. And 3 into x, because the concentration of x has been increased 3 times. So 3 into x raised to the power 2. And so this will be become equal to 9 into x square. And 9x square, it means what? The new rate, suppose this r dash or r prime is equal to k into 9x square. And initial rate was equal to r is equal to k into x square. What we see, if you take the ratio, we divide both the parts of equation, two equations. So what we see, the r prime divided by r is equal to k into 9x square divided by kx square. So k will be cancelled out, x square will be cancelled out. So r prime divided by r is equal to 9. So r prime is equal to 9 into r. It means the rate of reaction will be increased by 9 times. And even the simply one can understand by looking at this expression, if the b square is there like here, or x square was there, you increase the concentration 2 times, the rate of reaction will be increased 4 times. You increase the reactant's concentration by 3 times, the rate of reaction will be increased by 9 times for the second order reaction. If you increase the rate of initial concentration of reactant by 4 times, rate of reaction will be increased by 16 times. If you decrease the concentration by half, concentration of reactant for a second order reaction, the rate of reaction will be decreased by 4 times. And so this thing, we can, such questions we can answer. Now let's look into the integrated rate equation. Integrated rate equations, what we know till now, that the concentration dependence of rate is called differential rate equation. Because what we see, this rate equation, or one can write d minus dr by dt equal to this, for that equation is called the differential rate equation. And that we see in this equation, rate of reaction depends on the concentration, and that is why the concentration dependence of rate is called differential rate equation, this one can say. So it is not convenient to determine the instantaneous rate. As we know, to find out the instantaneous rate, first of all we have to plot a graph between concentration and time, and then with that graph we have to find at particular instant what is the slope, and with that one may find it. And that too, to get the slope, what we have to do, we have to make changes in the time very small. The infinitesimal change in time will lead to very small change in the concentration value as well. However, with certain tricks, with the help of graph, one can find out. But this is a lengthier task. So one may find out the rate of reaction using differential rate law, but that will be a bit tricky task. So to make this difficult thing a bit easier, so this is what we do. We can integrate the differential rate equation to get the information in the terms of the concentration that we see in the real thing that we can measure, which are actually experimentally measurable quantity. So in order to avoid this difficulty, we can integrate the differential rate equation to give a relation between directly measured experimental data and directly measured experimental data or concentration at different times. So time one can measure and the concentration at different times one can also find out. And so these are experimentally determinable quantities, and so that's why it is important to integrate the differential rate equation to get the values in terms of that variable, in terms of concentration and in terms of time t. And the integrated rate equations are different for the reactions of different orders, And this is why, because the order of reaction will be there in this rate equations, and that's why we, if you put the order and if you integrate it, that is dr by dt, so then in the integration what we will see, different orders and rules of the integration is a bit different. For example, if we start with the zero order reaction, so zero order reaction is what? It means that the rate reaction is proportional to zero power of concentration of reactant. So zero power of concentration of reactant rate is dependent. It means the zero power of the concentration of reactants, anything power to zero means what? One. It means the rate of reaction will not depend on the concentration or the initial concentration of the reactant. And one can write the, for the representative reaction R gives P, if it is a zero order reaction, so one can write differential rate equation, rate is equal to minus d concentration of r divided by dt is equal to k into concentration of r raised to the power 0, because 0 is the order of reaction and r to the power 0 is 1, so this minus dr by dt is equal to k. So what can I write? Later on is minus dr by dt is equal to k, so minus dr is equal to k dt. So dr is equal to minus k dt, one can write here. So dr is equal to d into concentration, d of concentration of r is equal to minus k dt. Now one can integrate both the equations as I have explained, because we want to integrate the rate equation. So one integrating this equation, what can we do? So this integrating d concentration of r will give the concentration of r. And this is a constant, and dt will give t, and this minus sign will be there, dt by t divided by 1. So one is not a plus and a constant of integration, which one can write as I. And where I is a constant of integration. And this constant of integration, what would be the value of constant of integration? One may find out at this method, if at constant time t is equal to 0, concentration of r is equal to r naught, which is the initial concentration. So concentration of r, suppose is r naught, one can represent it as r naught, which is the initial concentration of the reactant at time t is equal to 0. So I can write here r as r naught, this value minus k into time is 0, so k into 0 plus I, so k into 0 will be equal to 0, so I will be equal to r naught. So I will be equal to r naught, and that value I can put now into this equation. So here it is shown, so r naught is equal to minus k into 0 plus I, so I is equal to r naught. Now on the value of I can put here in this equation, so the concentration of r will be equal to minus kt plus concentration r naught, that is the initial concentration of reactant, and so this equation we obtain. If you look at this equation carefully, you can see this equation resembles the equation of the straight line, which is y is equal to mx plus c, where m could be minus k, the slope. So m is minus, the slope is m is slope, and c is the intercept, which is r naught, which is the constant value, because initial concentration must be constant, whatever the concentration of r naught is. After you have taken initial concentration, there is a constant value. Although this concentration is changing at different times, but initial concentration is still the same. So anyway, so R, one can write R is equal to minus KT plus R naught. This R naught will be the intercept. One can plot a graph between R and T and will obtain a straight line, because this equation is the straight line equation. So the plot between concentration of r and time t will give us a straight line, and the straight line, the slope of that straight line, one can see mx is something which is on the x axis, and on y axis is the concentration of r. So y is y is r here, concentration of r, and t is on the x axis. What is the minus k? Minus k is the slope, so k will be equal to the minus slope. Minus k is slope, that is what we know is m, so k will be the minus slope, and this r naught is the intercept, and this value, this much is what the initial concentration, and we know as the initial concentration is there, and rate of reaction doesn't depend on the concentration here, because this rate of reaction is constant throughout with the time. The rate of reaction doesn't depend on the concentration, as in the case of the earlier equations that we had seen. So for the zero order reaction, rate of reaction doesn't depend on the concentration, because the rate of in the rate expression or rate law, rate equation we have seen, the k into concentration of reactant to the power 0 and reactant to the power 0 is 1. So rate of the reaction will be equal to actually k, which is the rate constant value. So the rate of reaction is the value of will be equal to k, which is the rate constant. So zero order reactions are relatively uncommon, but they occur under special conditions. And some enzyme catalyzed reactions and reactions which occur on metal surfaces are few examples of zero order reactions. So enzyme catalyzed reactions and the reactions happening on the metal surfaces, and particularly reactions happening on metal surfaces at very high concentration, are the zero order reaction. For example, one can see the decomposition of gaseous ammonia on a hot platinum surface. So the platinum surface is the catalyst here, and is a zero order reaction at high pressure. So at high pressure, this reaction is a zero order reaction. At low pressure, this may not be the zero order reaction. So this ammonia, two molecules of ammonia on decomposition give one molecule of nitrogen and three molecules of hydrogen gas. And the rate one can write as k into concentration of ammonia raised to the power 0. Zero is the order of reaction, and so the rate will be equal to k, as I said. So rate of a zero order reaction is always equal to k, which is a rate constant. So at high pressure, the catalyst surface gets saturated with ammonia. This is an important point. So why is that high pressure that this reaction is the zero order reaction? And this is because at high pressure, the catalyst surface, means the platinum surface, is saturated with the ammonia. And so once it is gets saturated with the ammonia, and slight change in any other factors won't affect the concentration of ammonia at the catalyst surface, so the reaction will not depend on the other factor, particularly concentration of the ammonia. So at high pressure, the catalyst surface gets saturated with ammonia molecules. So a further change in reaction conditions, means a slight change in the concentration, do not alter the amount of ammonia on the surface of the catalyst, making rate of reaction independent of its concentration. So the thermal decomposition of HI, hydrogen iodide, on gold surface is also an example of zero order reaction. Let us now look at the first order reactions. In the first order reaction, what we know, you can write, what is the first order reaction? One can write the rate law. So if the representative reaction, we can again write R gives P. So one can write rate as minus dR by dt, and is equal to K in the differential rate law or a differential rate expression. So K into concentration of R to the power 1. Concentration of R to the power 1, 1 is the order of the reaction. So K into concentration of R, so minus dR by dt is K into concentration of R, is the first order rate expression for the first order reaction. So in the first order reaction, the rate of the reaction is proportional to the first power of the concentration of reactant R. So rate of reaction, we can see, it is proportional to the first power of concentration of R. And so rate is proportional, k is constant, so rate is proportional to concentration of R to the power 1, and that's why we get this rate expression. So one can write here as d concentration of R by R, just rearranging this equation, d, so this means the right minus this d concentration of R dt is equal to minus k concentration of R. So d concentration of R divided by concentration of R will be equal to minus k dt. Positive will go, this has gone to right hand side, this was in multiplication here. Now one can integrate this expression to the both sides, so this will be the integration of this will give us ln R, that we know dx, integration of dx by x is, on integrating dx by x we get ln x, so dr by r we get ln r. And mind the integrating this, we get minus k into tt, integrating t plus a constant, which we call constant of integration. And this is a value of this, the constant of integration I, one can determine again as we have seen it for the zero order reaction, because at t is equal to zero, concentration of R this concentration of reactant R is, suppose if it is R naught, this is the concentration that we had started with. And so when concentration at when T is equal to 0, R is equal to R naught, and where R naught is the initial concentration of the reactant, then ln R naught will be equal to minus K into 0 plus I, because 0, this is 0 is the time, and the value of time we can put here in this expression. So we get value of I as ln R naught, and so we can put the value of I in this equation. So we get ln R is equal to minus KT plus ln R naught, and so this expression ln R is equal to minus KT ln R naught. So here one can see this ln R naught. R naught is a constant, and so ln R naught will also be a constant. T is the variable with the time reaction proceeds. So T is the variable. K is also a constant. Another variable is concentration of reactant R, because with the course of reaction, concentration of reactant is also changing. So one can draw a plot between ln R and T, and if one draw a plot between ln R and T, one can again get the straight line, because this equation again resembles the straight line equation y is equal to mx plus c. However, y here is ln R and c is ln R naught, unlike to this zero or order reaction. There y was R, concentration of R, and intercept was concentration R naught. Here we get this the same thing with the ln value. So ln R is the y, on the y axis is ln R, and at the x axis t we put, and so we get the intercept as ln R naught, and slope will be here equal to m x. So x is t here, so m, the slope, is equal to minus k, so k will be equal to minus of the slope. Now one can rearrange this equation. This is what we get in this type of plot. So one can rearrange this expression as kt is equal to ln R naught. So I can take this kt here, it will become positive in one step. In the next step, I can write kt is equal to ln R naught minus ln R. This one, as we know, ln x minus ln y e is equal to ln x by y. So one can write ln R naught minus ln R as ln R naught by R. And so k will be equal to 1 by t ln R naught by R. And what one can get if one wants to change the log ln is what the base e. So if you want to convert this natural base to the base 10, what can we do? We have to multiply this log base 10 with 2.303. So one can write log on R naught by R as 2.303 log R naught by R. This was ln was base e, here this log is base 10. So we have changed this to base 10. So this was base natural base, base e, base 10. So k we get this ln as R naught by R is equal to 2.303 log base 10 R naught by R. So 2.303 one can write here. And so we get k is equal to 2.303 by t log R naught by R. This is a very important equation which one should remember. Now one can again rearrange this equation. And rearranging this equation, what can we get is ln R is equal to minus kt by not ln R. Let me just correct it. This log, this is log R, log base 10 is equal to log R naught. So this equation is also, it also resembles the straight line equation y is equal to mx plus c. So m here will be equal to minus k divided by 2.303. In this case it was simply the minus k. In this case it will be minus k divided by 2.303. Means this is log R is equal to minus k divided by 2.303 into t plus log R naught. Log R naught is a constant, which is intercept here. know, similar straight line one can find out, or one can also find out this equation. So log r naught by r is equal to k into k divided by 2.303 by t. Log r naught by r is equal to k divided by 2.303 into t, and that equation will also resembles an straight line resembles a straight line equation where the intercept will be zero. So what I mean to say is this, with this also one can get similar expression there where this value will be log r naught, but the slope will be changed, and that slope, and this is also the slope will be this. Let me just rewrite this expression so that this graph can be explained. Log r naught is equal to k divided by 2.303 into t. And so one can again just compare this with the straight. This is also in a straight line equation. This is the variable log r naught by r, because value of r is changing, and r naught by r will also change. Although r naught is constant, but r is changing, so log r naught by r will also be changing. And this k divided by 2.303 is also a constant, which could be the slope, and t plus 0, one can write t is the time that this will be changing, so t is also a variable here, and the concentration, and plus 0 one can write, so the 0 here will be the intercept, and that is why this graph is, it starts with the 0 and from the origin, and we see log r naught by r versus time plot, we see it goes from the origin, starts with the origin, and the value of the slope here will be k divided by 2.303. So similar different type of graphs one can understand, and sometimes questions are also asked based on the graph. This equation can also be rewritten in the form of this, similar to this, and one can get a different another graph. Now rewriting this above equation, what can we do? So what we get here is the kt minus kt is equal to log r by r naught. In this equation one can write minus kt is equal to log r minus log r naught. So minus kt will be equal to log r, means log r minus kt r naught. So minus kt will be equal to ln r minus ln r naught, and ln r minus ln r naught will be equal to ln r divided by r naught. So r divided by r naught will be equal to e to the power minus kt, the exponential to the power kt, this we know, this changes, and so this base is actually log base e, so log base e r by r naught, and so e to the power minus kt will be equal to, once we take the anti log, and then we take the anti log, the will be equal to r by r naught will be equal to e to the power minus kt, and this is what I have done here. So I took the anti log of this expression here to get this expression, r by r naught is equal to e to the power minus kt. And so one can write our concentration of r is equal to r naught into e to the power minus kt. This is also, this equation is also an important equation. And so r, concentration of r, means this concentration is the concentration at time t. R naught is concentration, initial concentration, and at time t is equal to 0. And E we know, and K is the rate constant, T is the time. So hydrogenation of ethene is an example of first order reaction. So hydrogenation of ethene cannot be hydrogenated because ethenes are saturated. So by mistake I took the said ethane. So ethene has unsaturation, one double bond is there, so that pi bond, the hydrogen can be added along the pi bond, across the pi bond. So two hydrogen atoms will be at two different carbon atoms. C2H4 gaseous plus H2 gaseous with C2H6, this is ethane. The rate, this is an example of first order reaction. The rate of this reaction will be equal to concentration of this rate constant into concentration of ethene to the power 1. The rate of this reaction doesn't depend on the concentration of the hydrogen. So this equation is the first, or this reaction is the first order reaction. So all the natural and artificial decay of unstable nuclei takes place by first order kinetics. So the radioactivity, all the radioactive reactions, the nuclear reactions are first order kinetics. So one should also remember the radioactivity, the first order kinetics. The order of reaction is the first, the one. On the example, one can see here is the radon 226. So radon 226 atomic number is 88. Atomic number is for the radon. On decomposition, it gives one alpha particle plus, means the helium plus this. So it decomposes into helium plus radon. And so helium plus radon, and this is the decomposition, and this is the rate, and this decomposition is the radioactive decay. One can see this as the alpha particle, and this alpha particle can get electron and differences to get become helium. The rate of this reaction is equal to K into concentration of the radium to the power 1. So initial concentration of radium, or even is the first order kinetics at any time, the concent, whatever the remaining concentration of radium will be, the rate of that reaction will depend on that. So rate is equal to K into concentration of radium to the power 1, and the first order kinetics is the all radioactive decays. So decomposition of N2O5 and N2O are some other examples of first order reactions as well. So decomposition of N2O5 and N2O are also first order reactions. What is important to remember here is the radioactive decays are first order kinetics. And the questions were asked earlier, where it was asked, so what is the order of radioactive decay, and the radioactive, all the radioactive decays are first order kinetics. Now let's look into this question. So the initial concentration of N2O5 in the following first order reaction. So the N2O5 gaseous gives 2NO2 plus half O2, and it follows first order kinetics. Was the initial concentration was 1.24 into 10 to the power minus 2 mole per liter. So this was the initial concentration of N2O5 at 318 Kelvin. This reaction is happening at 318 Kelvin. And the concentration of N2O5 after 6 minutes was 0.2 into 10 to the power minus 2 mole per liter. So once the reaction starts happening, this decomposition starts happening, and after 60 minutes, what was observed, that only 0.2 into 10 to the power minus 2 mole per liter of N2O5 was remaining. And this was the concentration is given. We have to calculate the rate constant of the reaction at this temperature, or the reaction temperature. So what we know here is that two concentrations are given and a time is also given. So one, there are two ways one can solve this equation. One way is the initial concentration is given. So initial concentration is also a concentration at a given time at t is equal to 0. The initial concentration is given, so one can directly apply this equation. K is equal to 2.303 divided by t, where t here is a 60 minute, and log R naught is given, value of R naught is given, this one divided by value of R, and value of R here divided by concentration of R is given this much. So one can directly get value of K employing this equation. This equation, as I said, is very important. However, sometimes what happens, the questions are given, the initial consultation is not given, but the consultation at two different times are given. So we'll try to solve this equation in such a way that one can apply the same idea for the different type of questions as well. So now for a first order reaction, what we know, the ln r is equal to minus kt plus ln r naught, and this equation, ln r is equal to minus kt plus ln r naught, and if that at the time t1 concentration is r1, this concentration is r1, and at time t2 concentration is r2. So what can we write? So at time t1, this ln r1 is equal to minus kt1 plus ln r0, one can write, because this is the initial concentration. Now at time t2, concentration is r2, so ln r2 is equal to minus kt2 plus ln r0. And now one can write 1 minus 2, one can obtain 1 minus 2, means subtracting equation 2 from equation 1, so we get ln r1 minus ln r2 is equal to minus k t1 minus t2, and thus this one can write k t2 minus t1. We can multiply this with, or when the one just make this t2 minus t1, and so minus 1 will also come out from this, so minus 1 into k, minus k will become k. So minus k t1 minus t2 is equal to k t2 minus t1. You can do this mathematics, which is very simple. Now ln r1 minus ln r2, I can write ln r1 divided by r2, and this one and this one, because this is the same, so it will be cancelled out in subtraction. So ln r0 minus ln r0 will be 0, it will be cancelled out. So now we reach here, ln r1 divided by r2 is equal to k t2 minus t1. So now I can change the base of the log. So this was base e. To change it to base 10, we have to multiply with the this thing with the 2.303. So 2.303 log base 10 r1 by r2 is equal to k t2 minus t1. So log r1 by r2 is equal to k t2 minus t1 divided by 2.303. Now I can write the value and log the value of r1 at one concentration at time 0, we know which is the initial concentration, because the initial concentration was given. So one can, as I said, directly apply this equation, but one I can do also consider that at the time t1, the concentration is this one. So at time t1, in this, the concentration was given, which was t1, this is 0. So t1 is a 0 at the initial concentration, so 1.24 into 10 to the power minus 2 mole per liter I can write, divided by concentration at time t2, which is at the 60 minutes, and it was given 0.2 into 10 to the power minus 2 mole per liter. You can see these values here. Right. R2 at time t2 is the concentration, and initial concentration is at time t1, which is 0, is this. And this the is given in minute divided by 2.303. Now I can write k is equal to 2.303 divided by 60 minutes. So k will be equal to this 2.303 divided by 60 minutes into this term. So I can write here 2.303 divided by 60 minutes into log 1. This well. And 2.303 divided by 60 minutes, and this is a log 6.2. You can get this as 6.2, and so finally solving, what we get 2.303 divided by 60 into log 6.2, we get 0.0304, and this minute will become per minute, because it is in denominator, so we can write it as per minute. The same can also be obtained if employing following equation as I explained earlier. Let us now consider a typical first order gas phase reaction, because what I have said earlier, because this, what we have seen, these are the not the gas phase reactions. One can consider the gas phase reactions as well, because there are many reactions which happens in the gas phase. And like this reaction, that example we have seen this question. All the reactants and products are in the gas phase. So in the state of concentration, it is easy to find the pressure of the reactant or product. So thus, the gaseous reactions, we also deal everything in rate and other terms in the terms of pressure or the partial pressure. So let us consider a typical first order gas phase reaction, where the A which is a gaseous reactant, gives B gaseous plus C gaseous. The example we can see here, N2O5 gaseous gives NO2 gaseous plus half O2 gaseous or O2 gaseous. So, and if Pi be the initial pressure of A, so we are starting with the A as we have seen for the N2O5. We have started with N2O5, the initial concentration. So Pi, the initial pressure of A, the instead of initial concentration, we are taking initial pressure of A, the reactant, and Pt, the total pressure at time t. So Pt be the total pressure of time t. So what will happen as soon as we take this A, it will start decomposing. So after time t, some molecules of A will already be decomposed and some molecules of B and C will be formed. And the stoichiometry of this equation suggests that one mole of A decomposes to give one mole of B and one mole of C. It means, and we know from the Avogadro's law, molar volume for the gas is proportional to the number of moles. So the similar thing, the number of moles, what we see for the number of moles, similar things we can also do, one can consider it for the gaseous volume. So suppose X volume of A reacts or A gets decomposed, so it will form X volume of B and X volume of C as well. So now here one can consider here, and here and total pressure at time t, one can write from the Dalton's law of partial pressure. The total pressure will be equal to pressure of A, partial pressure of A plus partial pressure of B plus partial pressure of C. So at total pressure at any given time t will be equal to Pa plus Pb plus Pc, where Pa, Pb and Pc are partial pressures of A, B and C respectively, and this we get from the Dalton's law of partial pressure. Now one can write this expression again, A gaseous gives B gaseous plus C gaseous. And suppose at time t is equal to 0, we have started with only A reactant and the initial pressure was Pi atmosphere. We have taken and the initial pressures of B and C will be 0 because we have not taken any product. Only the pure reactant was taken. Now, in time t, suppose X volume or the X atmosphere of A decomposes. So X atmospheric pressure, it gets decomposed, it reacts. So what will be the remaining pressure at time t of A will be Pi minus X, because Pi was the initial concentration pressure of A only. So X volume is it the X volume of A reacts. X volume of X reacts, and according to stoichiometry and the Avogadro's law, as I said, X volume of V will be formed and X volume of C will also be formed. Since pressure, we are measuring the partial pressure, the volume in the atmosphere. So this is the X one can write. So Pi minus X atm, X atm, X atm. So if the X be the decrease in the pressure of A at time t, the increase in pressure of B, C will also be X atm each. And so we know the volume, and from the volume, we know from the Boyle's law, volume is proportional to pressure. That is a different thing. So I think this is clear up to here. So Pi is the initial pressure at time t is equal to 0, we know. So Pt will be equal to that at time t, the total pressure will be equal to that time t, the total pressure one can write as the sum of the partial pressures of all the chemical species. So it will be equal to the Pt will be equal to Pi minus X atm plus X atm plus X atm. So that this X atm and this X atm will be cancelled out. So it will be equal to Pt will be equal to Pi plus X atm. So Pi plus X atm. So X will be equal to Pt minus Pi. So Pt minus Pi one can write. So total pressure one can measure, partial pressure, it is difficult to measure partial pressure of all the gases at any time t, but the total pressure one can measure, and the initial pressure, it was the initial when the reactant was there, so initial concentration pressure is also measured. So the value of X one can measure as Pt minus Pi according to this record method. And so now I can put the value of X here in this equation, the value of X Pi minus X, and the value of x, if I put here, I can get pressure of A at time t. And so to get the pressure of A at time t, I'll put the value of x, and that we obtained in terms of Pt minus Pi. So Pa at time t will be equal to Pi minus x. And this is equal to Pi minus x is Pt minus Pi. So this is minus Pi minus Pi will become plus, and so Pi plus Pi will become 2Pi minus Pt. Now in this equation, we know we have obtained this equation that constant K is equal to 2.303 divided by T log concentration of initial concentration of R divided by concentration of R at time T. And this concentration, as we know, with the concentration term, we can also replace with the partial pressure accordingly. And so K will be equal to 2.303, and how these things will be there, I have explained these things in more details earlier in the chemical equilibrium chapter. You can see the concept there. And so Pi by Pa one can write, and the K will be equal to 2.303 divided by T log Pi divided by the value of Pa, that we can put here as 2Pi minus Pt, 2Pi minus Pt. And so the initial pressure and pressure at time t is given. If it is given, one can also find out the rate constant. So what the rate constant at time t, initial pressure, total pressure at time t is given, total initial pressure is given, time is given. With the, from that also one can obtain the rate constant value for the first order reaction when the reactant and products are in the gaseous form. Now let's see this question. The following data were obtained during the first order thermal decomposition of N2O5 at constant volume. So N2O5 gives two N2O5, the stoichiometric reaction. So 2N2O5 gives 2N2O4 gaseous plus O2 gaseous. This is a balanced equation. The serial number, what is given? The serial number and time given, total pressure. So at time is equal to 0, the total pressure was 0.5. So initial pressure is given. And at time t, which is in the second 100 second, the total pressure was 0.512. We have to calculate the rate constant. The total pressure is given at time t. What we have to, follow this method, the method that I have explained, to get the value of rate constant, although the equation that we will be following is this one. But first, I start with this thing. So let the pressure of N2O5 gaseous decreases by 2x atm in 100 seconds. So if you assume that 2x atm pressure of N2O5 decreases, so one can assume that the 2x atm of N2O4 will be formed, because whatever the molar concentration we see, x mole this is reacting or decomposing, so x mole of this will be formed. So the mole, the amount, proportional to the amount, according to amount, the pressure will also be changing, because P, pressure is proportional to the number of moles that we know in the ideal gas equation. PV is equal to nRT. So the instead of n, one can directly consider the pressure. Similarly, volume one can also consider. So what we know, the volume one may consider directly at the place of number of moles, or one can also consider pressure at the place of number of moles, because in the ideal gas equation we know PB is equal to nRT. So if the volume is constant and the temperature, volume, the volume of the vessel in which the reaction is happening, temperature is a constant, R is anyway constant, so the pressure will be equal to the number of moles. So anyway, accordingly this equation is written. So if the 2x by 2x atmosphere, the pressure of N2O5 decreases, so the 2x atmosphere, the N2O4 will be formed, so its pressure will be increased. Initial pressure was 0, the pressure of N2O4 at time t will be equal to 2x atmosphere. And the O2 only 2 moles of this on decomposition gives 1 moles, so 2x atm of this will give only x atm. Now the total pressure at time t one can obtain as partial pressure of N2O5 plus partial pressure of N2O4 plus partial pressure of O2, and this will be equal to 0.5 minus 2x. So this was initial pressure, and this by this much it has a pressure of 2.51 decrease. So 0.5 minus 2x is the remaining pressure at time t, remaining pressure of 2.05 plus 2x is the pressure of 2.04 plus x is the atm. All the values are in atm. X atm is the pressure or the partial pressure, one can see the partial pressure of O2. Now this 2x minus 2x and this 2x will be cancelled out. So what we get, 0.5 plus x atm is the total pressure at time t. So the value of x one can obtain here as x is equal to pt minus 0.5 atm. So pt minus 0.5 atm is the value of x. Now the value of x I can put here in this here. So the pressure of N2O5 is what, 0.5 minus 2x. Now I can do 0.5 minus 2 into value of x from here I can put. So this is pt minus 0.5, and this minus and minus will become plus, and 2 into 0.5 will become 1. So 0.5 plus 1 minus 2 into pt. So the 0.5 plus 1 becomes 1.5 minus 2 into pt atmosphere is the pressure of N2O5 at time t, and this time t is 100 seconds, and pt is given at the time t. Pt is given, this value is given in this question. See that time t 100 seconds, that time this pressure pt is given. So I can put this value here in this equation. So p N2O5 will become equal to 1.5 minus 2 into 0.512 atm, and this will give us 0.476 atm. Now I can apply this equation or this expression. K is equal to 2.303 by t log pi by pa, and so, and pi by pa, and here pa I is the initial compressor of a, and this pat is the pressure of a at time t. So the just I have used the same equation but just change the representation. Now the k is equal to 2.303 divided by t. T is 100 second is given. Log pressure of N2O5 initial pressure divided by initial pressure of N2O5 at time t. So 2.303 divided by 100 second log. Initial pressure of N2O5 is 0.58 atmosphere. And the pressure of N2O5 at time t means 100 second, we have obtained as 0.476 atm. So 0.476 atm. So again, the 2.303 divided by 100. So this will be equal to 100 second log 0.5. So the same thing I have repeated here. So just let me just remove this thing. It is not giving any extra information. So this will be, the k will be equal to 2.303 divided by 100 log. This value atm will be cancelled out, log 1.0504, and so 2.303 divided by 100 second into log of this is 0.0214. This is log base 10. One can get the value, and after doing this all the calculations, one can get it as 4.92 into 10 to the power minus 4, and this second is in denominator, so it will become, it is s to the power minus 1. So the rate constant for that reaction is 4.92 into 10 to the power minus 4 per second. And this is how one can solve this kind of questions. We will, I hope you understand this thing. Very easy. The only thing that we have to understand is pressure at constant temperature is proportional to the number of moles. Constant temperature and constant volume is proportional to the number of moles. So in the place of number of moles, whatever you see the number of moles, you can do the similar things for the pressure as well. So as the 2x mole of this decomposes just to form 2x moles of this and x moles of this. So the 2x atm of this will decompose to form 2x atm of this and x atm of this. This is the only thing one need to understand. The rest of the tricks, this kind of things we have seen in the chemical equilibrium as well. And the only thing is, all this trick we get is to find out the partial pressure of the reactant at time t. So the idea to use this trick was to find out the partial pressure of N2O5 at time t, or the partial pressure of reactant at time at time t, because what we measure is the total pressure, and the total pressure from using this trick, from the total pressure one can also at time t, because total pressure contains the partial pressures of all the reactants and all the products. And from that total pressure, one can get the partial pressure of reactant, and using that partial pressure and the this equation, one can find out the value of rate constant. While I stop here.